Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of Roosevelt House, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this very special evening. Many of you have been here before to enjoy book discussions like Irish Apparel, The Last Great Senate, or hear world leaders like Kofi Annan, or explore how to improve America's public schools with Secretary Arne Duncan. But tonight's different. As some of you have known, having been here before, I want to have a series of conversations with the most interesting people I know. Ed Koch was my first guest, followed by former MoMA President Agnes Gund, Vartan Gregorian of the Carnegie Foundation, civic leader Rita Hauser, who's here tonight to enjoy not being on the hot seat, and most recently, Jim Lipton of Inside the Actors Studio. Gus, we have a seat for you right up here. Tonight, I'm going to be talking with Lewis Lapham, founder and editor of Lapham's Quarterly, and also a friend of over a quarter century. He and I made common cause at the new school when he was a trustee during my tenure as president. Lewis has written about money and class in America, and we will want to understand how his own early life provided a lens through which to view this topic. He grew up in San Francisco, where his grandfather had been mayor. His great-grandfather was a founder of Texaco, and his father an executive in the shipping business. He went to the Hotchkiss School and Yale and studied at Cambridge. He became a journalist right after college, working as a reporter for the San Francisco Examiner and the New York Herald Tribune, before joining Harper's Magazine, where he worked from 1971 to 2006, most of the time as editor and only with a brief intermission. He then started Lapham's Quarterly, a journal dedicated to helping us make sense of the world through a deep understanding of history. He is the most prolific writer I know, contributing to Life, the National Review, Forbes, Fortune, Vanity Fair, Parade, Maclean's, The Times, The Wall Street Journal, and much more. Sometimes it seems like he is everywhere, in the bookstore, in your morning newspaper, in magazines you read, on public television. Recall his six-part documentary, America's Century, and remember that wonderful show, Bookmark, and currently on Bloomberg Radio as host of The World in Time. And somehow he's found time to write 15 books with titles that draw you in: The Imperial Masquerade, The Wish for Kings, Democracy at Bay, or Pretensions to Empire, Notes on the Criminal Folly of the Bush Administration. And that's just a sample. Now, I want to say, and I'm sure I'm right about this, no one reads Lewis Lapham for relaxation or to have their comfortable worldview validated. Every encounter is a challenge to inherited orthodoxy and contemporary punditocracy. Lewis Lapham challenges us to think for ourselves in the belief that when we do collectively, we will make good choices about our leaders and public policies, provided we do our homework, learn from history, and have a robust and open debate. Lewis confounds people who try to classify him on a left-right political spectrum or apply some other convenient label. I think I know how I would describe him, but I'm going to put my theory to the test in the next 50 minutes or so, and then we'll open the floor to questions. So, Lewis, if you'll join me, we'll get started. Our sound system in this room isn't perfect, so we have to talk right into these mics. I'm going to start just by a couple questions to establish our connection, and then we'll get on to some general topics. So I start with the new school. What did Board Chair Dorothy Hershon see in you, and what about the new school attracted you to serve on its board? And we have a former chairman here in Malcolm Smith, and one of our great trustees, in Jean Lang as well.
Well, I was utterly charmed by Dorothy Hershon. I found her to be always interesting, full of ideas, and I couldn't resist. Whatever she asked me to do, I would do. And the new school, I looked at as an adventurous sort of approach to education. It had welcomed Thorsten Veblen when he was otherwise mocked in the society at large.
A little louder, Lewis, please.
It has a wonderful history. I mean, it attracted people like Thorsten Veblen and Hannah Arendt, and it had a feeling and a reputation for open, courageous, creative ideas. And it had that history, and you, Jonathan, and certainly Dorothy, persuaded me that that spirit was alive and well, and it was a lot of fun.
Speaking of fun, I've learned a lot from Lewis, and I've learned that you can get bored in a typical New York social setting, where conversations sometimes can be a little, shall we say, predictable. But not with Lewis around. Lewis, you have a way of sparking a conversation. Some would call it dropping a bombshell in. Do you recall that evening at 21 West 11th Street, the President's House, which ended up, I think it was on page 6, if I remember correctly, and was that just a, remember what you said, and was it spontaneous? Is that how it goes, or do you think about these?
No, it was spontaneous, and I'm having trouble remembering it. Is it the evening when I suggested that women couldn't write essays?
That's the evening.
Yeah. Yes. There had been a discussion that afternoon on feminist literature and so on, which was a very lively topic at the time. And then at dinner it came up, and I began to wonder why I'd had so much trouble as the editor of Harper's Magazine finding women who could write essays. I could find women who could write wonderful novels, who could write diaries, who could write reports, but relatively few, Joan Didion being an exception, that could write what I think of as an essay. And I still have that trouble editing Lapham's Quarterly, because I'm trying to take writing from across the last 3,000 years, and I'm trying to get as many different voices into the Quarterly as I can. I mean, not only the voice of somebody like Thucydides or Tolstoy or Gibbon or Charles de Gaulle, and so forth, but I keep coming back to a relatively small number of women, Virginia Woolf, Edith Wharton, sometimes Pearl Buck, but it's difficult to find it. Now that of course is historical, because the women were not welcomed into the world of letters for a long time in Western civilization. They were not, as you know, allowed to sing in church until the late 19th century, so that the hostility of the, certainly of the Christian church in Western Europe toward women was pronounced. But and George Eliot writes wonderful novels, but it's difficult to find an essay. So I was trying to make that point, and I was not trying to be outrageous about it. It was a matter of my observation.
Well, you framed this within a larger assertion, which is there were certain things that you really couldn't write about in this politically correct world, and that was the most explosive for the group in the room, but you had two or three others, which I won't burden you with now, but there was a string of unmentionables. Let me move back a little bit now that we sort of established that we have known each other for a bit and can talk about sensitive topics. Coming back to your childhood, we've known each other for 20 years, and I still can't predict where you're come out, where you'll come out on an issue, and I can't really place you on a political spectrum, as I said earlier. I said earlier in the introduction, you come from a very prominent family. Talk to us about your early years, the experience growing up in San Francisco. I recall your family had a famous encounter with labor leader Harry Bridges. Your father ran the port of logistics for the port of San Francisco. What was it? What was your what were the shaping influences? And tell us a little bit about your early political journey.
Well, my early I'm born in 1935, and in 1940, and the family, we were in the shipping business, the American Hawaiian Steamship Company. We had 52 ships. It was intercoastal trade. It would come down the west coast of America, Seattle, Portland, San Francisco, Los Angeles, through the canal, Gulf Coast, up to Bangor, Maine, and back. This is before the Eisenhower Highway development, and this was the cheapest way to move large dry cargo. It was easier to do it in larger bulk than on the trains, and it was a very successful business. On December 7th, 1941, we had four large piers in San Francisco, and as I say, 52 ships. The government took all 52 ships on December 8th. 47 of them were sunk in the North Atlantic convoys in the spring and summer of 1942, and we essentially went out of the shipping business. My grandfather, however, was elected mayor of the city in 1942, and he was very interested in trying to give me some kind of political education, and so I would accompany him at the age of 7, 8, and so on his political speeches, and when the ships, the carriers came into the bay, the mayor would go out on a launch to greet Halsey or Nimitz on board one of the carriers, and he'd take me with him, and we'd go up the, get piped aboard and meet the admiral, and it was very romantic, as you can imagine, for a young boy. And then when grandfather was in 1945, when they were chartering the UN, he, as mayor, presided over the sessions in the Opera House, and he saw to it that I was excused from school to attend the plenary sessions of the chartering of the UN. And then, of course, my father was dragooned into giving cocktail parties for the delegates, so I can remember at the age of 10 passing canapes to John Foster Dulles and Molotov and Stettinius. And I learned grandfather was a very good politician. I mean, he liked people. He always practically answered his own phone. I mean, and when he would drive around in the city in his own car, he'd pick up hitchhikers and talk to people. I mean, he liked to talk to people. And I can remember also, he was colorful as a mayor. He wanted to pass a bond issue replacing the streetcars on Market Street with buses. He wasn't going to harm the cable car, but he wanted to replace the trolley car with a bond issue. And there was some doubt in the public mind as to whether that was a good idea. And so he framed it as a bet. He would race a trolley car from the ferry building to City Hall. He would ride an elephant. And if the elephant beat the trolley car, the bond issue would pass. If not, not. But he was also a gambler, so he insisted on a handicap. The elephant was allowed to go through red lights. And the elephant won, and the bond issue passed. So. And then after that, he was chosen by the Marshall Plan. He'd been on the War Labor Board in the early years of the war, and then he was the first guy picked for the Marshall Plan in China. He was sent to China in 1947. He was the last American out of Shanghai when Mao came in, and then from there he went to do the economic reconstruction, the Marshall Plan in Greece, supporting the monarchy in Greece against the revolution in 1949.
And so, growing up, did you have some political heroes and heroines?
Well, FDR was my political hero at the age of, 10, 11, 12. FDR and of course, Churchill were my... I mean, I grew up with that in mind.
Well, Churchill and FDR are right behind you. Of course, Stalin is there, too. So talk to us a little bit about moving from San Francisco to New Haven, bypassing Lakeville. Talk to us about Yale. I know you and I share admiration for a guy named Charlie Garside, history professor. You thought about being an historian, I think, but then something at Cambridge told you something about yourself that changed your mind. What? Tell us about that.
Well, okay, at Yale, I entered Yale in 1952, and I wanted to join the Naval ROTC. I wanted to become a carrier pilot because that was very romantic during the war. The carrier pilots in San Francisco would fly upside down under the Bay Bridge, and they were very romantic figures. But I didn't qualify because I was colorblind, so I couldn't get into the program. And then I ran across Charles Garside, who, when Jonathan was at Yale, he was an extraordinary teacher. He was a man of enormous enthusiasm and learning, and could awaken in the minds of his students truly the joy of learning. And he was a polymath. He spoke several languages. He was a musician. He understood the history of, he could relate Bach to the Reformation, to what happened in the Renaissance, and the conversation was miraculous. And I became his disciple, practically, as a freshman. I had run across him as a freshman. And so it would so happen that I would be assigned a paper on Andrew Marvell in one of my English courses. And Garside was in the habit of dropping around my college room at midnight, and we would go and have coffee in the Greek coffee shop on Chapel Street.
Only coffee?
Yeah. And then Charles would read the, he'd say, "Now show me what you've written," and I'd show him what I'd written. And he'd tear it up. And he said, "You can do better than this. This is, boilerplate. I mean, work at it." And so I'd go back and rewrite it between 2 and 8 o'clock the next morning. And then, of course, I'd fail because of the teacher. I would get comments from the professor that I got on that particular paper. I can remember getting a C with the comment, I don't care what you think about Andrew Marvel. I only want to know that you know what I think about Andrew Marvel. so I had trouble with the, you know, essentially I was educated by Charles. I was on the honors list by the end of freshman year, so I didn't have to attend class, and I practically never went to class at Yale. I mean, I would have a continual seminar with Garside, and then it kind of drop in lectures that he thought were worth attending. And then I'd spend all my weekends in New York. I mean, I'd come down and I had access to an apartment that Auden had here in down near Washington Square. And my idea of a perfect weekend was to listen to Auden and then go over and watch Dylan Thomas drink himself to death and then go up to Birdland to listen to Charlie Parker play the saxophone. That was my idea. I only went to one Yale football game, the first one in my freshman year, never went to another one. So I was in the minority at Yale, but it was an exciting minority. I knew people in the music school, in the graduate school, in the drama school, and there was a lot of talent floating around underground at Yale.
When did you first realize the depth of your talent as a writer and thinker? Who other than Garside, is there someone who helped you sharpen your skills in writing, and who are some of the role models you had?
The man that I learned the most from was a man named Otto Friedrich. Otto Friedrich was the editor of the Saturday Evening Post in the middle 60s, and I left the Herald Tribune to become a contract writer for the Saturday Evening Post. And Otto was a true historian and intellectual. His father had been a great German scholar and historian at Harvard. Otto had grown up in the scholarly atmosphere of Harvard. He would play every year. He'd play through all of the Mozart piano concertos, just, you know, the same way my grandmother used to read the Bible every year. Otto would play through the Mozart concertos, and he wrote 14 books while he was the editor of the Saturday Evening Post, and he wrote them about things that interested him. He wrote a biography of Henry Adams's wife, Clover. He wrote about Germany in the 1920s. He wrote about Hollywood in the 1930s. He wrote a book about Manet. He wrote a book about the Krupp family. I mean, he was endlessly curious and filled with, you know, he wanted to find a story to hearten his fellow man. And it was my ambition as a young contract writer for the Post to be able to turn in a manuscript that would go pretty much straight into print, that I could get it past Otto's blue pencil. And that never happened. Otto usually would, I would spend a week working on the first three paragraphs trying to get the lacquered phrase, the perfect word. And then inevitably Otto would cross out the first three pages and say, it begins here, it begins on page three, because this is where the story begins. So it was the story, and then Otto's markings were really useful in the margins. I've seen a manuscript marked up by Harold Ross when he marked up John Hersey's Hiroshima piece for the New Yorker. And they're meticulous. I mean, they're in tiny pen, fountain pen, and, you know, they're like footnotes in Gibbon's Decline and Fall. And Otto was the same way. Why this word and not that word? How do you know this? Mm-hmm. You know, and so on. And so I learned a great deal from him.
So I've asked you about some of the people who were role models and mentors, both family and not. Who along the way in the early going disappointed you, whether they be public figures or friends or colleagues? And how do you deal with disappointment and even betrayal?
Well, I try to go right by it. I mean, I really do. I mean, I don't bear grudges. I don't try to even the score. I just, you know, that's the way it went. Okay, maybe the next game will be better. You know, I try not to dwell on that because there's not much to be gained. I mean, it's at least as far as I can see.
So maybe a name or so to give us an example of somebody who disappointed you. Could be somebody in public life. In the early going.
I can't. I don't know. I was disappointed with some of my teachers at New Haven. I can remember that. I can remember having my final examination in Shakespeare as a senior, and had the first half of the examination was spot identification for 50 points. Who was Mercutio? That kind of thing. It was awful, and the it was a tremendous difference going from Yale to Cambridge. It was like going from a minor league baseball team in Mobile to Yankee Stadium.
I was born in Mobile.
Okay. Pick another town. All right.
That's all right. Instinct for the juggler. Anyway, Cambridge was...
Cambridge was magnificent. Yeah. I can remember going to my first tutorial in the fall of 1956. And I had been encouraged, not only by Garside, but a number of other people at Yale, to follow the profession of a historian. I mean, they led me to believe that I knew what I was talking about. So I go to the first tutorial, and it's a damp day, and there's a coal fire in the grate, and the elegant Don, and we're both wearing gowns. It's the Magdalen College Pepys Library, and old silver tea, and now he's going to try to find out what I know. And it was spectacular. The English can do this in a way that is so polite and so devastating. I mean, and he said, what do you want to study? And I said, well, I'm here to study medieval history. And he said, well, perhaps you can spare a few words for the 12th century. And I ran through noble paradigms. I mean, I had all these kind of, you know, the Ptolemaic universe, the way that Aquinas saw the world, the meaning of the facade, west facade of Chartres, the shape of the canals in Amsterdam, and, you know, large, you know, New York Times editorial page like conclusions, and I could keep the balls in the air for about 5 minutes, and then he said, perhaps, what were the currencies in circulation in the 12th century? What were the prices bid for Russian fur and Christian slaves in Istanbul? What was the time of travel by sea from Dover to Marseille? What was the time of travel by land from Bruges to Milan? That kind of thing.
Yeah.
And I, of course, open-mouthed. unable to answer anything. And he said, you know, he said, you Americans, he said, you're wonderful, wonderful. He said, but you have this talent for grand simplification that is denied to your poor cousins here in England. And that before we reach the noble paradigm, we like to have at least a passing acquaintance with some of the facts.
That's great. So let me take you back here. You worked for the San Francisco Examiner, then the Herald Tribune, my favorite newspaper growing up. Did you get disillusioned along the way about the world of journalism? Why did you shift from that to Harper's?
Yeah, I did get disillusioned with the newspaper business. Because you could only take it so far in 300 words, and you had to take down. You could go, for example, the mayor would be giving a press conference, and you could know that the mayor was lying, but you weren't there to question him. You were there to take down what he said, and also often there was an idea in the head of the editor before you went out to wherever it was you were going, and unless the idea came matched. I can remember for the Herald Tribune, I was sent out to Pittsburgh. They were running, Rockefeller was governor, and we were concerned about nuclear fallout bomb shelters, and the Navy had built a bomb shelter in a gymnasium with glass walls that you could look into and not look out to see how people would behave in a bomb shelter under nuclear attack. And it was a box that was maybe 8 feet high and 7 feet across and 15 feet long. I mean, no bigger than this half of the auditorium. And 24 people had been in there for 2 weeks. And they were of all ages. I mean, there were children under three. There were men and women over 75. And they had organized themselves into a society.
Interesting.
And I came in with a guy from the Times. And we were both allowed in for the last 24 hours. And, of course, the smell was appalling. I mean, and so was the temperature. It was, God, it was over 100 degrees, nobody had a bath. And so, on the other hand, the thing that was fascinating was they didn't want to leave. They had organized themselves into a society where everybody knew where they stood in relation to everybody else. They'd worked out a routine for when people slept and when people didn't, and they had formed a congruent whole. So, okay, the thing is over, and we come out, and I go to the hotel room and write the news story. And wrote it that way.
Yeah.
But what had happened before it went into print at the Tribune, the Times guy, his story had
speaking of the mic
was already in the paper. So, and his story was completely different. They couldn't wait to get out. All they wanted to do was what was happening at the World Series. They couldn't have cared less what was happening at the World Series, and so. My story was completely rewritten by the guy in the rewrite guy in New York to match the Times story. Okay, so that was lesson one. But then I had lesson two. Not long after that, when the game was reversed, I was on the rewrite desk one night, and John Denson was the editor, and we got a. Three-paragraph story from Moscow reporting a meeting of the Soviet Academy of Sciences. And all it said was this Academy of Sciences. It was three bland paragraphs. And I'm sitting there putting that into the paper. And Denson, the editor, looks over my shoulder and he says, that means World War III. That means that the tanks are on the way to the Fulda Gap. And I said, Mr. Denson, how do I know that? How do you know that? And he said, I'm going to give you a name, and you call his name, and he will explain it to you. So the name was Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was then a young hotshot at Columbia. And I called Brzezinski, and Mr. Brzezinski, and explained to him, read him the three paragraphs, and explained that Denson knew that this meant World War III, and that you, Brzezinski, are going to explain it to me, which he did. And so the Tribune ran that on page one, off lead, page one, column eight, imminent war, you know, that kind of thing. And the it came up in the first edition, and needless to say, there was nothing in the New York Times on that topic. However, by the late edition, the Times had woken their poor guy in Moscow and asked him why he'd missed it, and the Times had it the next morning.
Yeah.
So I began to, you know, the methodology of the newspapers was beginning to, I also wanted to write at greater length, so that's why I went and became a contract
writer.
And
what was the secret of your success at Harper's? It was Harper's?
Well, no, I went to the Saturday Evening Post first, and then to Life.
Yeah.
Life magazine, before I got to, and they both, of course, folded.
That's why I want to get you onto Harper's.
Yeah. By the time I got to Harper's magazine, I'd been working for five. When I first came to New York in 1960, there were 9 or 10, 11 newspapers in New York.
Yeah.
And the by the time, and the Saturday Evening Post and the Life were the major mass media, but they were displaced by television by the end of the decade.
Yeah.
I mean, it becomes a whole new game.
So Harper's, tell us about. Harper's was a tremendous success under your editorship. It was a long and good run. What made it so successful?
Well, I liked writers, so I was always looking for people who could write well, and then I would give them their head, more or less. I mean, they try to find people who are talented and give them the space to show their stuff, and that turned out.
And you once, I'll come up with this question in a minute. Let me move on to a little more contemporary. In assessing the 2002 election, you were talking with Bill Moyers, and you said the oligarchy won, and then you went on that the Congress represents the frightened rich, the people who think that the democratic experiment has served its purpose, run its course, gone far enough. Bush appealed to the country's weakness and fear. And my question is, do you have a different view of the recent election? Does Obama appeal to our strength and confidence?
No, I don't think he does. I think both parties appeal to our fears and talk about an imaginary, you know, the notion of America in decline is not news. I mean, the all ages are ages of anxiety. That's one of the wonderful reasons for reading history, is because it teaches you not to despair of your own circumstance. I mean, if you think of what people faced, you know, in the Civil War or during the early years of the Republic, during the Depression, during World War II. I mean, the times that one lives in are always under siege, right? I mean, the idea of a lost golden age is nonsense. I mean, it's usually an image floated by a reactionary status quo that is basing the projection of a redeeming tomorrow based on the borrowing, subprime borrowing from an imaginary past. I mean, the whole idea of the American West is invented by the Ronald Reagan version of the American West. Essentially, was created by Ivy League swells at the end of the 19th century. I mean, it's an invention of, among others, Teddy Roosevelt and Owen Wister and Frederick Remington, all Harvard, Yale, by the way. Remington never even went west of the Hudson River. I mean, his paintings of, the cowboys, I mean, the cavalry officers, they were models posed on sawhorses in Yonkers. Okay. So you get the literary idea of the West, and then we get the production values are added by film merchants who arrive in Hollywood from Warsaw and Minsk in the 1910. I mean, it's completely imaginary. I mean, it wasn't like that at all. And the so the when people say, as the politicians were saying in the election, we're going to take America back. Back where? I mean, by what means of conveyance? I mean, aboard the Mayflower? Or at the point of a gun. I mean, you see what I mean? I mean,
yeah. Go ahead.
Well, I mean, so again, I'm saying that's a value of history. I mean, it teaches you that the boat has always been in a pretty hard sea, right? And it's no good pretending that, I mean, you can tell each other the truth about where, I mean, the whole basis of American democracy, as I understand it, is Fenimore Cooper, who writes a wonderful book called The American Democrat, which he publishes in 1837, in which he says that the fundamental virtue of a democracy is candor, is telling each other the truth. I mean, we're all of us embarked on a speculative and perilous journey. That's the proposition. And if we don't tell each other what we know and where we've been and what might be around the next bend, we turn our institutions, in Cooper's phrase, into a preposterous fraud.
Well, speaking of our institutions, you see the flaws in our system deeply embedded in our charter documents. You once wrote of the Founding Fathers, and I quote, "They undertook to draft a constitution that employed an aristocratic means to achieve a democratic end. But then money got involved. Good intentions like mother's milk are a perishable commodity. As wealth accumulates, men decay, and sooner or later an aristocracy that once might have aspired to an ideal of wisdom and virtue goes rancid in the sun, becomes an oligarchy distinguished by a character that Aristotle likened to that of the prosperous fool. Its members so besotted by their faith in money that they therefore imagine there's nothing that it cannot buy." Now, given that view, and I speak as a board member of Common Cause and its idealistic director, Bob Egger, was right here a few months ago, believing that the system could be reformed. Do you believe the system could be reformed? given what you what you've said?
Well, I think the system can be reborn. I mean, I think in that language that you just read, it's my own language, but the idea is taken straight out of Aristotle. The as of which the founders were very much aware. I mean, in order to set up a government, to write a constitution, I mean, it was going to be done. I mean, it's always the privileged few that end up writing the constitution and or setting up a government in order to distribute law and property to the less fortunate many. That's the way it's always happened. I mean, if you say to yourself, the historical record does not show any government of the poor, by the poor, and for the poor. It doesn't exist. And so the idea when it starts, and this is Aristotle's point when he takes you through the circle of the four transformations of government and how they lead into one another, and you start out with, as Madison says this, Madison said that we here, in drawing up this Constitution, we are people with the most wisdom to discern and the most virtue to pursue the good of society. They believe that about themselves. And again, democracy, if you read Montesquieu, democracy is based on the idea of virtue. It's quite different from monarchy, which isn't. And they try to impart that. And it's a marvelous document. But it is not like Magna Carta. It's not about a sharing of the commons, implicit in a bountiful wilderness. It's a means set up by men of property, hospitable to the acquiring of more property. It has that, but it also wants to take account of the public as well as the private good. A democratic society. It and a capitalist economy are different. I mean, and the Constitution tries to reconcile that difference. That's the argument between Paine on the one hand and Franklin on the other hand. And it works as long as the people that are operating it take it seriously and are attempting to I believe in elites. So do they. So did our founding fathers. But after a while, if everything goes up for sale, I mean, Jefferson knows this. Jefferson says, money, not morality, is the principle of commercial nations. This is the basis of his argument with Hamilton and the bank. And when you end up where money becomes the supreme good and becomes essentially the civil religion, and you begin to think that money can buy everything. This is what happened to the Greeks. This is what Aristotle's talking about. This is what the Greeks had the word for it, pleonexia, that's a disease. And and of course it wrecked the Periclean democracy.
And so is there...
And it wrecked Rome. And it wrecked the Ancien Regime in France.
Is there a way out of this? I mean, you said...
Yes, there's a way out of it. I mean, you know, times change. I mean, people come up with a new kind of ideas. I mean, we came up with... I mean, look what we came up with in the 18th century. I mean, look what they came up with in Philadelphia. There's no... I mean, people can... We have to get a new idea about man's relation to nature. And the idea that the market thinks is not a good idea. And that has to be shown to be calamitous. So I mean, the American dream as we've now got it constructed is one of infinite growth, and infinite growth in a planet with limited resources is a fool's errand.
And what is the what are some candidates for the big idea?
I don't have one. I mean, thank God, I'm not a mystic, or I'm not a Tom Paine. I mean, I'm not, but we're not putting the same kind of political energy, I mean, energy and thought into politics was really important to the people in the 18th century. And it isn't among us at the moment. I mean, what's important to us is money. And what was important to the 17th century was religion. I mean, different things become important. And I think what's going to become important in the 20th century is man's relation to nature, the environment, the pressure on water, the population, the whole, you know, they're going to be, whatever, 9.5 billion people by the year 2050. And how do you control them? How do you provide for them? I mean, how do you distribute the limited goods? I mean, we're going to end up rationing water pretty soon. And but in order to deal with it, it's not a problem. I don't think technology can solve the problem. Mm-hmm. I think the problem is a political problem, and it's going to take people to think about it as a society, to give more of our time and energy to that kind of thinking than to the consumer market.
So that brings me nicely to Lapham's Quarterly and the uses and misuses of history. What was the inspiration for Lapham's Quarterly? How is it doing? How do you choose topics? And do you think it'll survive you?
I do think it will survive me, because I think it's a very simple formula. The formula it can be expressed as the great books made topical. And idea, all really successful American magazines have been digests of one kind or another, and have been presenting information that people can find useful. That was a success of Reader's Digest. That was a success of Time Magazine. And I'm borrowing on that model for Lapham's Quarterly, because I think of history as an immense resource, an inexhaustible landscape of the human record. I mean, it's our inheritance. I mean, I like to quote the line from the poet Goethe, who said, "He who cannot draw on 3,000 years is living hand to mouth." And that's true. I mean, and the root of all education, whether it is economic, social, political, sexual, is history. And so what I am trying to do with the Quarterly is to introduce the historical perspective, the acquaintance with history over a large block. I mean, you know, we have 224 pages, and we have as many as 80 texts. You know, Confucius, Shakespeare, Tolstoy, Churchill, I mean, Galbraith, I mean, depending on, we take the great authors and focus it on a particular topic. So one quarter I did, and we'll do it, the topic is war. Another one, it's money. Another one, it's religion. Another one, medicine. Another one, nature. Another one, education, politics. And you try to focus these the accumulated thinking, wisdom. I mean, what in the New York Times a couple of years ago, I read an editorial saying that the instruments of the media amplify the voice. That's what the media does. And that's true, but what magnifies the voice is its power of expression. And that lasts over time. I mean, you can read today Thucydides or Juvenal, or that's why Shakespeare's plays are still performed in Central Park. I mean, the force of the imagination and the power of its expression does not die.
I'm going to ask one more question here and then open it up to the audience. In Feast of Fools, that issue, you wrote, and I quote, "If the words in this issue of Lapham's Quarterly survive the fall of empires and the death of kings, it's because they were conceived as being worth the risk." So my question is, give us an example of one or two of the biggest risks you've taken in life, not just as a writer, but in life, and have you ever paid a price for risk-taking?
Well, I take a risk every time I write an essay. I mean, and I've written a lot of them, and the essays are the thing that distinguishes an essay from, let's say, a tract or an annual report or a campaign speech is you don't know where it's going to end, and you can make a tremendous fool of yourself, and I've done that often, and therefore have been. I've made a lot of mistakes. In other words, I take the same premise that Montaigne takes. He begins with the notion, what do I know? And so I usually start out with that in mind, and usually turns out I don't know very much, but I can speculate, and I enjoy speculation, but it often turns out to be a losing venture.
Well, let's open it up to the audience. We'll
exist anymore in our country. It used to be leading churchmen, then leading presidents of universities, but it's hard to think of the person, a public intellectual, writes on whatever pleases him and makes some waves. And do you see yourself that way, or do you see yourself fundamentally as just a writer?
Well, I see myself as a writer, and I don't see myself as a pundit. I assure you of that. I see myself as an essayist, speculating on whatever is drifting across the surface of the news, right?
Yes. Let's get your microphone, and if you would just give us your name, please.
I'm Richard Cohen, one of the many Richard Cohens in New York. In fact, I was once invited to a party where only Richard Cohens were allowed to attend. It's building on your question about risk, actually. Have you ever done the equivalent, Lewis, of riding an elephant through the red lights i.e. taken an unusual step, which was crowned with glory at the end?
Good question.
I'm not sure whether I ever have or not. I don't know whether I've ever done that. I mean, I could say that getting married is a risk. I mean, and that's been very successful for me. I mean, I love the elephant. Richard Cohen, by the way, is himself a truly fine writer, and I'm happy to say is one of the many people on the board of Lapham's Quarterly, because I don't do this all myself. I have a board of historians and writers who suggest topics.
Other questions, maybe on this side of the room? Yes.
I was interested in your point about looking back and being sad about looking back and not seeing any promise there. And we sit here in Roosevelt House. And I have a slightly different view of the period, starting in the 30s, but actually the legacy of Roosevelt from 1950 to 1980 is something, in my view at least, and I'm raising the question with you, a period in which we actually had a modern middle class and working class society that was working for us. And the question is, do you think looking back at that period gives us some promise for the future starting now?
Yes, I think that can happen. I mean, I'm also, as I say, I do this weekly broadcast for Bloomberg, and I'm doing talking tomorrow to an author who's written a book called The Age of Innovation, and he's talking about the 1820s, 1830s, and 1840s in the United States, where the suffrage is first granted to most males, and it's a period of enormous energy, and it is a creation of the middle class. So it does happen, and periodically. I mean, and in the essay I was talking about, I mentioned that. I was talking about the 1830s, 40s, and 50s, and about the 1950s, 60s, 70s. So, yes, I mean, the game is not over, you see. I mean, but the other thing you have to remember about history is that the only thing you can change is the past. I can't change the future, because the future doesn't exist, and the present isn't around long enough to establish a mailing address. So if I'm going to change anything, I mean, change the way we think, it's going to be because there's a wonderful Arab proverb that goes, you have less to fear what might happen tomorrow than to beware of what happened yesterday.
Maybe on that, yes, Bill Hubbard.
Have you seen or do you have any opinion on Oliver Stone's documentary, History of the World, and one aspect of it, which is that all of post-World War II events in history would be different if Henry Wallace had not been displaced as a vice president?
Well, the what-if games are entertaining, but you can't. That's not a productive line of investigation. I mean, look at it this way: if there's no fog in the East River in August of 1776, Washington doesn't get the army across the river, and that's the end of the American Revolution. I mean, you can play all those numbers, and I don't know enough about Henry Wallace. I liked the Stone series. I mean, I've seen seven of them, the TV, and I've read the book, and it's a lot better than it's being given credit for, I think, by some of the more established historians. He's not Stone. What he's really doing is he's just simply asking questions. He's not pretending to be an expert. He's not pretending to have all the answers. But he's raising questions, and he's asking about America's involvement in the world, starting with the Spanish-American War. And I mean, and why is it that in my lifetime, I'm 77, and the United States has been in a constant state of war my entire life? Why is that? Why are we a military power? To what end? I mean, and it's changed the circumstances of my you know, the feeling of freedom and liberty. I can remember having that kind of a freedom in the 50s, and I'm now living in a society where, you know, frightened of its own shadow, with surveillance cameras, homeland security, a war on terror, which is at war against an unknown enemy and an abstract noun, and it's not a war. The Bush administration spent the entire 8 years trying to terrify the American people. And when you do that, the purpose of that is to gather more power for the state. And I actually have experienced this over my lifetime, and this is what Stone is talking about, and he's showing it to you. I mean, it's better as a documentary than it is as a book. You can argue with, you know, his interpretation of the Truman administration. You can argue about who got us into the Cold War, whether it was Stalin or whether it was our own commercial interest. But there's a lot of truth, and the pictures are extraordinary. I mean, there's a lot of film footage that I thought I'd seen a lot of 20th century newsreel, but it's, I found it very interesting. It's got full of holes like most everything else, I thought it was enlightening.
I'm going to take one more question from the audience, and then, yes, and then I have a closing question.
Susan Rubinstein, thinking back to the times when the United States was on a positive path, like the 40s and the 50s and the 60s, when we had a thriving middle class and the country was doing well, or the 1830s, 40s, and 50s, when innovation was at a peak. Do you see any similarities in either the leadership, in what's going on in the country, in the life of the people that exist today, which would lead you to believe that we might get back to that stage, or are the differences so severe right now that we're overcoming bigger obstacles than we did at those stages, and are we in for a much more difficult journey?
Well, I mean, I can think that it's things are going to be difficult, but democracy is the most difficult form of government, and it requires participation. And how do you do that? I mean, in 1800, there are 3 million people in the United States, and the vote is limited to men of property. Women are not allowed to vote. Blacks are not allowed to vote. And there's a very high degree of literacy. And that carries through into the 1820s, 30s, and 50s. I mean, you read Tocqueville, and the people in the middle of the rural Ohio are reading newspapers, are learning Latin. I mean, even the politicians in the 1840s, knew Latin. I mean, Lincoln didn't, but Seward did, and so did Salmon Chase. So our education system, and the other problem, of course, is the population. I mean, we now have 330 million people in the United States, 10% of whom can't read. And we have television, and television isn't interested. Television is advertising, and it isn't interested in political regeneration. I mean, how do you find a language describe a revivified politics? Again, let me quote Orwell. Orwell says, "He who controls the present controls the past, and he who controls the past controls the future." That's Orwell's point. But the language and the whole point of his essay, The Politics of the English Language, is that unless you can, he's saying the same thing that Fenimore Cooper is saying. Candor, you've got to try to, it's the good use of words that induces the change of heart. And before you can have a change of policy, you need a change of heart. And how do we instill that, and who instills that in enough of the American electorate to have some kind of political consequence? I mean, the great thing about Lincoln is his language. As it was true of FDR too.
I'm going to ask the last question. Lewis, I'm going to give you a choice, an either or you can do both. So the first question, let's say the big thought question, asking you to sort of sum it up. You've been a prolific writer, distinguished editor, a public intellectual for a long time now. How would you describe, or hope that somebody else would describe, your impact on American thought, culture, and democratic practice? That's the first question. The second one, should you choose it, is to tell us the role of the seven iron in your career.
I'll tell you the role of seven iron. It's a much easier question to answer. The my effect, I think, has been, to tell you the truth, Jonathan, minimal. But the seven iron
is, I don't agree with that.
The seven iron story is when I was in Cambridge, England, in 1956-57, and I came back to the United States, and I didn't know what I wanted to do. I had suddenly become interested in American foreign policy because I was explaining to British colleagues. I was trying to explain the policy of John Foster Dulles, and it was very difficult. And so I'd been recruited tangentially at Yale for the CIA. So I went to Washington and applied for jobs at the White House, the Washington Post, and the CIA. And those places were all the same place in 1957, right? We were all on the same side. And I had a very romantic idea of the CIA. I wanted to wear a trench coat and get on and off trains to Berlin with very good-looking blonde girls. I mean, that was my idea of the CIA. But I studied for it. I mean, I went to I didn't quite have things written on my cuff, but I'd passed all the physical and the psychological examination, and so now came the interview with some of the younger guys they had Quonset huts in those days down near the Lincoln Memorial, and I was 22, and the people I was being interviewed by were late 20s, 28, 29, maybe 31, and long, blonde table, plain table, Quonset hut. They're at the other end of the table, and they're straight. I didn't know this for a fact, but I'm sure that they were all members of the Fence Club at Yale. I mean, they all looked like George W. Bush, the second president. They dressed that way, and the enormous arrogance. And so, as I say, I had the first question. You know, I was prepared for full the gap, last train to Finland, the Romanovs, and so on. And the first question was, you are standing on the 13th tee at the National Golf Club in Southampton. What club do you hit? And they didn't care what I knew. They were just trying to find out whether I was the right sort to be able to play in a great varsity game of the Cold War? And I happen to know that question. It's a short haul. And the so if you're a good golfer, you'd hit a 7-iron. If you're not such a good golfer, you'd hit a 4-iron. So A, I knew the course, and B, I was a good golfer. I got that one right. Second question, and this is not a joke. This is my interview with the CIA. And the second question was, it is 6 o'clock in late August in the afternoon, and you are coming in on the final tack to the yacht club at Hay Harbor in Fisher's Island. What tack are you on? And I also knew that because I'd done that. The third question was, does Minxie Haynes wear a slip? Minxie was the great nymphomaniac wild woman of the Ivy League circuit in the 50s. And the not to have known Minxie was not to have been a man. You know, it was that kind of thing. And I said, gentlemen, I'd seen Minxie once dancing on a bar wearing a mink coat, but I had no idea whether she was what she was wearing under the mink coat. And I said to them, I said, gentlemen, my sources are Hungarian and compromised. I've had rumors of the Belgian lace, but I can't be sure of it. And beside that, I'm apologize for wasting your time, and I got up and walked out. And never again have I been surprised by the foolhardiness of the agency. I mean, these people thought, these three guys thought that they were masters of the universe, and they were questioning me for my, you know, was I the right sort? And I thought, goodbye and good luck. You're right.
You're the right sort for us, Lewis. Charlie Garside would be proud. Thank you for a wonderful, wonderful evening. Great conversation. Thank you all for joining us.